It's good to be back at Buzzwords 21. I wish we all met in Berlin and exchange ideas, but still excited to network and learn in this virtual format itself. My name is Amrit Sarkar, and in this session, we will get intuition of how to scale search clusters with open source software, Apache Solr, and orchestration tool, Kubernetes. A disclaimer before we move ahead, the solution discussed in this talk involves a functionality of Apache Solr, which will be deprecated in future version 9.0, which is autoscaling. We will still, though, look at how we are utilizing it such that a parallel simplistic functionality can be built. I work as an independent consultant and currently acting as an engineering manager for the search team at Tata Innstore Limited, where we have two e-commerce offerings to Asia Pacific, TataClick.com and Luxury.TataClick.com. Each has its own catalog. The search team, which is just 6 months old, broke down the current monolith architecture to its own microservice for the search query journey. And we are also rebuilding all the interfaces, product ranking, auto suggestions, along with building modern query classification framework. Post AWS migration early this year, we are now looking at Kubernetes as our next home for managing deployment. We know Apache Solr. It is an open source tool on top of Apache Lucene library. It provides a number of essential features for text-based search, like spell checking, highlighting, grouping, faceting, use machine learning models while learning to rank feature. Distributed mode called Solr Cloud can scale on the basis of traffic and other relevant metrics. It can stream results, and plenty more features are available. We at TUL host standalone Solr Cloud, Master Slave, and even Elasticsearch clusters to serve various search and suggest APIs across various products and use cases. Kubernetes also is being widely used across verticals today, unlike a few years ago. Various products and companies have adopted Kubernetes as a default deployment strategy tool for their entire stack of services. The open source community of Lucene and Solr have already built new features to make the job much easier for us. But still, there is a great deal of micromanagement involved, like migrating between Solr versions, expand cluster dynamically, or having multiple clusters in different regions in cloud to counter single point of failure. Developers and DevOps needs to be on point. There was a need of an hour for a potential manager which can accommodate such nuances, and Kubernetes can help us do that. We have a great talk on Solr operators tomorrow from the committers, and I'm looking forward to learn and how we are going to use it in our own journey. Kubernetes are an orchestrational tool, a system used for running and coordinating containerized applications across cluster of machines. Kubernetes maximizes capacity by logically and efficiently distributing containers. Containers have respective processes. Based on the demand, live traffic, more data segregation, the machines can be scaled up or scaled down. Moreover, it makes sure the processes we configure keeps on running and healthy most of the time. Kubernetes does all of this without any macro management. We are not dwelling into the details of Docker and Kubernetes in this talk, since there are multiple discussions being done previously. Now, I have discussed this slide multiple times in the past, but it is necessary to know how we run Solr Cloud and Kubernetes to understand the problem statement we are going to solve. Solr Cloud needs Zookeeper Ensemble for the management of configuration and cluster state information. Zookeeper process, in Kubernetes terms, pods are hosted by a stateful set. Stateful set create pods in unique order like ZK0, ZK1, and so on. These Zookeeper pods are attached with a persistent volume, which are not attached to the pod lifecycle. If one of the Zookeeper pod crashes due to various reasons, an exception, out of memory, machine got corrupted, Kubernetes will spin another Zookeeper pod on an available node, and due to its unique identification, same persistent volume will get attached to it. Zookeeper pod is exposed via two types of services, a headless service for internal communication within the ensemble, and a standard Kubernetes service which exposes an IP could be used by external service or application to communicate with it. A unique Zookeeper ensemble string generated from this module is then configured in our Solr set. On the similar lines with Zookeeper, Solr is hosted by the stateful set template for similar reasons. Solr cluster is exposed via two types of services, headless one for internal communication and standard one to expose it to other services. And finally, this Solr module is exposed to general traffic with either a load balancer or an ingress. an ingress, you can specify custom routes and paths to a set of services. And if you're running number of solar nodes, ingress makes it convenient. I have abstracted great deal of implementation details from node discovery mechanism to service discovery nomenclature. So please check out previous year's talk at various conferences to get the gist of it. We can deploy multiple solar cloud clusters within single Kubernetes cluster. All the resources, configuration, pod, services, persistent volumes, definitions can be isolated from one another via different namespaces. Resources in different namespaces can still talk to each other via definite discovery mechanism if there is a requirement. Now, before moving on with this presentation, allow me to kick off a short demonstration on the background. This time I have not configured any GCP or AWS server, but we are doing everything on a local setup in via Docker and Minikube. What I have done is what we discussed until now, the Solar Cloud Cluster, I have hosted it in the Minikube like this. We have three Zookeeper nodes creating the ensemble, and we have two solar pods creating our the solar nodes. We have respectful stateful sets here. We have exposed a bunch of services, some internal services for internal communication. And then there is another solar external test service I have exposed as a load balancer such that the Minikube tunnel can talk through it and we are able to access through browser. Coming down, they have the persistent volumes attached to each of the solar nodes and solar pods and the Zookeeper pods. And this is the Minikube dashboard, which gives out of the box capability to look at all the resources. Looking at the solar admin UI, I've kept it very simple since we are running this all locally. We have one single collection called sample, one shard, and just two replicas. Each of the replicas are hosted on two different nodes. And we have just around about 48 documents, and that's about it. Now, looking at from the command line, as discussed, we have two solar pods, three Zookeeper ensemble. In the Minikube itself, when you start Minikube, it starts off some of the services out of the box, Kube API server, storage provisioners, and so on. Kubernetes dashboard is specifically for the Minikube dashboard we just saw. And I have also deployed some monitoring tools here, and which we will discuss while we move on with the presentation. Before I go ahead, I'll just quickly execute two APIs and start off a Getlink script. I will start putting some load on our solar cloud cluster, exactly 25 query per second. We'll get back to this later of what we are doing here. I've also put up a quick Grafana dashboard where we have the number of documents, how many number of replicas we have for shard, and I have noted down, I have a widget with total request per rate and also an average request per rate. Kept it very simple. At this point, it is like 9.9, it is almost zero. No request is coming to it. The 1 minute rate is almost zero. So one of the problem statement the cloud team, which I was part of at my previous employer, tried to solve is to optimize our cloud services bill, yet not curb development speed by restricting use. If you're overutilizing your existing cloud infrastructure, you're likely to get limited performance benefits. But if you are underutilizing your machines on the cloud, it will be difficult to justify the bills to the finance team at the end of the month. We were facing this exact issue in a much bigger capacity at the current workplace, where post AWS cloud migration this year, we are billing much more than what we expected. Another problem statement we tackled was the unexpected spike in traffic in a sale period. We at Tata just celebrated 5 years of e-commerce business launch and received 1.5 times of the expected paid traffic before even the sale period began. A lot of preparation, thought, and efforts are put into place to set up the optimal infrastructure to handle this anticipated traffic. Teams allocate more resources to have the same buffer to support SLAs. So did we. We need to build a smart, intuitive, automated search system which can scale at high traffic, meet SLAs without manual intervention, and shrink down to minimal infrastructure such that we save cloud bills at low traffic time frame. So the solution design we are looking at involves three components: monitoring tool to report custom metrics from your application, in this case, which is Solr; Kubernetes horizontal pod auto scaling, which scales existing replica set, that is deployments or stateful sets, based on provided metric value; Kubernetes HPA provides the physical scaling of nodes; and then for the finally good old but now deprecated Solr auto scaling, which provides the logical scaling of replicas. Let's dive into these three components one by one and understand the relationship between them to set up scaling Solr clusters without manual intervention. So Prometheus has a very smooth integration with Kubernetes. The Helm chart for generating the deployment YAML is available at the stated link. Prometheus operator was added in the Helm chart. It provides easy monitoring of Kubernetes services and deployment, along with managing Prometheus and Alert Manager and Grafana. It is based on a service monitor, a custom resource definition to abstract configurations we need for a target application or service. This is a typical service monitor, which will match label stated here app colon Solr, and Prometheus operator will does the rest of the work of retrieving the metrics. And all these metrics are then can be visualized by Grafana. You can nail down to the node, number of pods running in that node, resource requested, and further level down to the exact Docker container running in your Kubernetes cluster and their resource management. Prometheus operator integration provides almost a dozen inbuilt dashboards in Grafana with respect to Kubernetes out of the box. And then we have Grafana dashboard for Solr, stating the heap sizes, overall memory consumption, resource usage at the thread level, request and response time series dashboards, latency, error rate, etc. We have built a custom dashboard for this talk just to focus on what we are building. Further on, the Helm chart also includes Prometheus adapter. On the left hand side, we have the config map, which maps existing Solr metrics from Prometheus server. In this case, we are mapping all metrics with underscore request at suffix. You can perform custom grouping, aggregation, also convert time series metrics to instant. These come very handy for production readiness. In our demonstration, though, we will be using the existing metrics out of the box without any aggregation or renaming. On the right hand side, we are deploying custom metrics API server in the Kubernetes monitoring namespace. The link mentioned on the top is the repository containing boilerplate code for setting up an implementation of custom metrics API. It is open source. The code includes setting up a generic API and registration of resources, and it serves our purpose perfectly for registering Solr metrics as a custom one for Kubernetes. All we need to do is to point this custom API server to already running Prometheus server endpoint. Next, the custom metrics needs to be accessible via Kubernetes tool. The service is registered as an API service. API service makes the metrics available at a definite endpoint as part of the Kubernetes API. If you look at the right-hand side, this endpoint, API's custom metrics Kubernetes V1 beta 1, will contain all the metrics we have captured. We can see metric select 1 minute rate from the Solr pods. This is a custom metric we have built for this demo. This is an important piece of the solution, and hence we will move back to the demonstration to see this custom metrics in hand. Now, what we did before the last time was we executed two commands. This is a command, this is a command for API custom metrics Kubernetes V1 beta 1. What I'm doing is I'm just grepping by Solr and pods. These are all the metrics which are available to us as a custom metrics one from Solr itself at a pod level. Searcher documents, cumulative cache, distrib latency, one minute rate, and so on. You can build more, you can customize the metrics based on your requirement. Now, if I look at one specific API, which is the select 1 minute rate, in this case, if I execute this command, we will get the exact value for the metrics value. In pod zero, solar pod zero, the value is 20 millis right now. And for the pod two, it's just zero. And if you look at the monitoring namespace, we have the Prometheus server running, operator running, adapter, node, exporter, and we have the custom metrics API server, which is driving all those custom metrics. Now, one of the premier features in Kubernetes is it allows auto-scaling pods based on an aggregation average or an absolute metric value. Stateful set solar with 3 pods is set up. Until the average value for metrics M is less than provided user value X, nothing happens. Suppose the metric name is CPU and X is 90%. If the average metric value CPU consumption becomes greater than 90%, that is more pods are added to solar and keeps on adding until the average becomes lower than 90% for the CPU consumption rate. This is a sample YAML configuration where we are setting the HP on a stateful set named solar stateful set with min replica 3, max replica 10. The metric name on this HP is the select 1 minute rate we just saw in the demonstration. And the target average value is 100. Value could be average like this, or it can be absolute. You can verify if you have set the HP correct by invoking kubectl command, and the current value at this time for the replicas is 3, since the traffic is 50 units, which is less than the desired 100. Now, auto-scaling in solar provide balanced and stable cluster for the various cluster change events. It is achieved by satisfying a set of rules and sorting preferences to set the target of a cluster management operation. What we really want to do here is to set a policy and a trigger at a solar cluster level such that every time a new node is added to the cluster, one replica for each shard for each collection is hosted on it. On the right hand side, a node added trigger with preferred operation add replica is set. What it does is whenever a new node is added, clusters are added to that node. Cluster policies on the left hand side is set such that in entire cluster, each node can have at most one replica for each shard. This needs to be done such that when a new pod is added by the trigger, only single replica is added. Now let's move back to the demonstration and see what has happened in the background. Right. This was the state before we triggered our Getlink script. We started to put some load on our cluster. Let's execute this command again. We can see another solar pod was hosted around 7 minutes ago. And if you look at the reason behind it, this is the Kubernetes get HPA, which we executed before we start the Getlink script. At that point of the time, the traffic was 0, replicas were 2, and the HPA was set as maximum of 3 pods can be hosted. If I execute this command again, I would be able to see now my traffic, the average traffic here is around 8.3, which is 25 divided by 3, 8.3. And I have now 3 replicas running out of the box. And with on execution of the custom API, all the 3 pods 0, 1, and 2 are almost sharing the load of the entire traffic equally with around 8.3 to 8.4 requests per second. If I come to my Grafana dashboard, yes, my number of replicas per shard has automatically, the configuration we have set up has been increased to 3. And we closely look at the total request rate and the average request rate. It was hovering around 24 or 25, what we have set up. But right after within the 10 minutes, when the average request rate went above 10, which we have set it as our target value. Another pod was added, and now it is going around the 8.3, 8.4 mark. You can see the overall target UPS has not come down, but the average has come down, and so did our SLA. And looking at our cloud view at Solar Admin UI, right now we have two replicas at two different nodes. And if I refresh, another node has been added, 16, which will be hosting the third replica. Now, all this looks great on the local setup. Each and every component used in this talk has no custom or a proprietary product being used. But probably this needs a bit more refining to make it production ready. Some HPCs needs to be handled. Suppose your cluster expanded from 3 to 10, and the replicas of the shard got hosted on the nodes 6, 7, 8. Once the traffic falls below target, all the newly created nodes will be removed along with the new collection. We probably need to set another cluster policy at a collection level, which ensures at least one replica of each shard get hosted on the nodes, which will never be removed. We host multiple collections in a single cluster, but probably don't want to scale all collection when target metric threshold is breached. Can we scale only set of collections or a particular collection? To do that, we need to dig deep into how Prometheus adapter configurations are written. If you remember from the previous slides, we were just renaming some metrics there. In this case, we need to group metric for custom API server based on your requirement. But since we are now familiar with the node added trigger concept, it will add replicas to all existing shards and collection if any of the nodes get restarted. That's its default behavior based on the configurations we have set. To mitigate the same, either we need hard-coded collection-based rules or dedicated control plane implementation to take care of it. So what is next? How can we improve on this? In our demonstration, we are running Solar Exporter Service as a sidecar container in each Solar pod. This Solar Exporter Service actually emits or captures the metrics from Solar and push it to or make it available to Prometheus. I did this intentionally to showcase that each Solar node process rate by a custom metrics API server. A better way to do it is to run an independent pod for exporter service pointing to the Zookeeper ensemble. Recently, Solar Operator is being open sourced as an independent component, which provides capability of managing metrics out of the box, and we would like to use it and not host it like this. Also, as discussed, auto-scaling feature in Solar is deprecated, and at this point of the time, we were not able to figure out an alternate out-of-the-box solution in open source, which will suffice our needs. We need to either build a custom application on the control plane to take care of it, or extend the capabilities of Solar Operator once we get a hang of it. These are the respected references for the content discussed in this talk. As mentioned, the demonstration for this talk was executed on a local system via Docker and Minikube. All relevant scripts, helm charts are available on the top link. Thank you again for attending this talk. I'm reachable at all social media handles at sarkaramrit2. I look forward to see each of you again next year at Berlin, and open to questions, comments if you have any. Cheers.
Thank you so much, Amrit. This was a great talk, and I learned quite a bit through this talk. I don't see any questions yet, but I have some of my own. So I'm gonna start off with those. So going through this talk, there's been a bunch of work that has been done in the past around replica placement strategy, ensuring you placed your replicas at the right location based on how your data was distributed in Solar in the past. And a lot of people kind of rely on it for different reasons. Is there something in all of the scaling infrastructure that you used, that you spoke about, that took into account the replica placement strategy that people might already have?
Sure. Yeah, all those replica placement strategy via solar auto scaling or out of the box will be taken into the account when this auto scales. So the cluster policies discussed in this talk was very simplistic. This is not how production environments will be run. If you have a custom or a business or a proper strategy is already into the picture, it will be respected. But at the same point of that time, the two new policies or the X number of policies for the solution to be introduced needs to work in the tandem. Yeah.
Okay. That's interesting. And before I take any other question, I have another follow-up, because this seems kind of like an anti-pattern to the idea of Kubernetes that kind of disconnects your infrastructure from your app, and replica placement strategy kind of makes that line a little fuzzy, kind of confuses me on that front.
Sure. Yeah, I think the stateless and the stateful thing comes into the picture here, right? The replica placement, or when we talk about Kubernetes, we don't need to worry about where our replicas are kept or where how the replicas needs to be placed. But at the same point of the time, with this solution, we have an X number of nodes which are static. When we talk about starting, these are the nodes which will never be removed. And then there are Y number of nodes which can go up and down based on the traffic itself. Within the static nodes or the static pods, we are calling it, your replica placement strategy can be respected. But while you scale up and the scale down, you don't have to worry about how your replicas are added and how they are removed. So both of stateful and the stateless things are kept into the picture.
Great. So we got a few questions. They've started to come in, which is great. The first one, and I think you already discussed it as part of your talk, but I'm going to let you say that again. Is there anything getting built as an alternate to solar auto scaling, which is getting deprecated in the coming versions of solar?
I'll be really honest. I have been following up the conversation regarding the solar auto scaling, and I don't think there is a solution which is at the moment available which does the exact same thing which solar auto scaling does. Any new feature, but we are now, I think, exploring the solar operator. For this solution, at least, there is limited capability we need to use from the solar auto-scaling part, and the operator should be able to handle that. We're still in the works. This is a POC state, so some work is needed there.
Yeah. Great. The next question is, what sort of operational issues did you run into with Zookeeper and Solar? When Kubernetes pods are going up and down, do you see size increases with overseer queues?
Typically, yes. Kubernetes HPA, horizontal pod auto scaling, is quite aggressive. At least it was aggressive in the previous version. As you see, I put that upper cap to 3 nodes only. It adds solar pods in a very aggressive manner, but that particular functionality can be tuned if you host your own Kubernetes. So there is a capability to tune that value so that pods are added in a slower rate and not in a such huge manner. So there was operational issues identified, but we can control it.